Yeah, of course. Remarkably successful. I didn't do anything. I didn't even do anything. I'm doing my job properly.
Maybe I can't get on with this too.
It's a bank.
Oh, I missed it.
There it is.
Pleasure to meet you again, sir.
How are you?
Yeah, trying to hear
Richard
your...
Richard Twain, spiritual leader of UKIP.
I can get nowhere. The sacked chairman claims to have suspended me. The NEC backed her up. I couldn't even stand in an election now. Seen a bunch of crooks.
But yeah, it's funnier than hell in UKIP. Well,
Ben Walker was criminally convicted in January this year.
It's a shame how they ended up a bit like here, where the people that are not running are holding all the power, where the people that
they don't care what the members think.
Yeah. It's very sad.
They're in a bunker. I think they're convinced that there's a sort of silent majority of members that support the NEC, and I don't think that's true, actually. I think that most of the members are fed up with it.
Yeah. But until they change the law, the problem is they make the rules, don't they?
At the last NEC meeting, I suggested a change to the... I suggested that with this NEC electronic ballot, we also said there's room to have three more questions as well as the NEC election. And I suggested that we put a question there saying that the threshold for a member's vote on constitutional change should be lowered from 2/3 to 50% of votes, so that if half the members voted for a constitutional change, then it would be mandated. They were up in arms, particularly Neil Hamilton, up in arms about the idea that the members should have the power to change anything.
What's the point of having voters when we haven't had the power to change what's happening? What are you hoping will happen in the election then?
Look, the best thing that could happen is that people look very, very carefully at who's on the ballot paper and make sure that we get as many real, true leavers into Parliament as possible. And of course, it means people must be taken in, because this Tory lot have been lying for the last 3.5 years about leaving. They're still lying about it. They want it never to happen, and they're doing a very good job of making sure that it never happens. And that's all they've really occupied themselves with for 3.5 years. So people need to look very, very carefully at who is actually standing, who's on the ballot, and decide, is that person genuine about really just leaving? And what it comes down to is this. I hope that we will vote for people who want what's now called no deal. I call it leaving the EU, because we've already got loads of deals.
There was no deal offered on the referendum paper. That's what annoys me.
That's it. So I hope that we will vote for enough people that actually believe in that we can make that actually happen.
Yeah.
Whether we'll get that or not, who can say? I think it's probably unlikely. But
because if the Conservative Party, I assume the Conservative Party will stay in power, but I hope it's going to be a coalition with the Brexit Party.
Anything can happen.
With the Brexit Party, so that they can pull the strings, like Parliament's been working recently.
But
so
Brexit Party is a weird one, because it's one issue.
There's a one issue.
It's got a lot of extreme left wingers in there. They've got some very pro-mass immigration people. And don't forget that Nigel Farage himself stood in an in-camera session in the European Parliament and argued for the 6-month extension. And just now I've heard him arguing for this extension as well. And he's only getting paid whatever it is a week to be in the European Parliament. So obviously, that's not affecting
his decision as well. Yeah.
No, I don't want extension. I want us to leave today.
Yeah, I want that.
But now. no deal. I don't care if they call it no deal, make it sound as negative as possible. It isn't negative, it's freedom. I want freedom now, today.
Do you know if there is any truth in the story that our armed forces are being signed over to Brussels tonight?
We've signed, as I understand it, we've signed 7 agreements. They're in the form of letters of statements of intent rather than in the form of kind of really like detailed binding treaties. But that's how the EU often proceeds. You know, you have these rather vague letters that say, oh, well, we agree to work together in this or that, the other way. And then 2 years down the line, the ECJ says, well, in this letter you said this. So boom, yeah, that's how it's going to be. Boom, yeah, you're going to do that. And so
that's it.
It's the creeping. It's what Jean Monnet described, you know, a process of seemingly insignificant steps so that the people won't notice their sovereignty being taken away, their military being taken away, their democracy being taken away. That's how they operate. That's the plan. And so I look at those PESCO agreements, the Permanent Structured Cooperation Agreement, and the European Defence Union Agreement, and that is part of that insidious process of creeping into control, and bit by bit you sign away the control, and that's what we've been doing since the referendum.
Well, since the end of the Second World War, we've been, since the whole conception with Walter Hochstein, since the first sitting of the EU, they've been working then, haven't they, all these years.
To be fair, in the 60s and the 70s, NATO was vital because, you know, it did face off the Soviet threat, which was a threat. And if people say it wasn't a threat, try being a Czechoslovakian during the Prague Spring, and then you know what a military threat really is, because the Soviet tanks rolled in and your prime minister had to resign. And that's, you know, that's real power. That's real power being projected militarily. So people that say it wasn't a threat, they're talking absolute nonsense. It was a threat. NATO faced up to it. We should be very, very nervous about undermining NATO, which is a very established defence for Western Europe, which is primarily paid for by the US. And we need to be very careful about that.
That's one of the very surprising things I find with the people that say the EU have kept a peace since
1992, after the end of the Cold War.
Yeah. And hang on,
1 minute, and then you're going to have to start.
NATO kept us much more peace for 30 years since the Second World War. Yeah. We had all that peace. So it's not the European Union keeping the peace, is it?
That's a complete anachronism. They've got the timing all wrong. You know, the peace came first. The EU came long after. You could argue that the EU hasn't been particularly good at keeping the peace. Certainly there were some of the problems on the Balkans, and certainly if you look at Ukraine,
Bosnia.
There have been plenty of examples of the EU doing a rotten job, actually, of keeping the peace. That's just a completely bogus argument. It's so obviously false. Anybody can check it. And it's amazing that people try to say it. It just proves how dishonest, or either dishonest or deranged, some of the fanatics for this great imperial project are.
And we lose all our own sovereignty as well, which is a terrible thing. And when they've got the power and we're living under the communist state, pleasure to me, once we're living under the communist state of the United Communist State of...
Good to see you. Nice to see you.
How are you? You're hanging around for a while.
Yeah, I'll be here.
Can I have a selfie?
It won't be a selfie,
though,
but okay.
No, it won't be. It'll be a back-to-front selfie.
They pick a yum and they know how all this technology works.
Come on, are you a boomer or something?
I didn't even have a coffee.
It was the one around. I've only got one hand.
You need to clean the lens. Thank you very much, Nicole.
Cool.
You need to clean the lens. Thank you. Yeah,
I'll check it's good.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you. We're here all day.
Hello, we meet again.
Yeah.
Hello! Yeah, we are.
Sorry, one hand taken.
Yeah, thank you for asking one question.
One for the NEC.
Thank you. Are we going to this meeting?
There is one for you, UKIP. Well, there's one for the UKIP
panel. Yeah. I didn't get a chance to shake your hand, Richard.
There.
Where are you going?
I thought you was going to
we'll see.
Be successful.
We've still got to find
out.